But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. Let me tell you about my great God.
Hey guys, Pastor Tim here. Hope you guys are doing great. Hope you're ready to start your day off in God's Word. We are on 1 Samuel chapter 28. All right, I got to get this on track. Forgive me, missed the past couple days, but I'm going to try to catch up with this week's video, so just stay tuned for them to upload later today. But we're on 1 Samuel chapter 28. We're getting to the point where we're very close to the end of Saul's life. In fact, this chapter starts off, it does deal with David very briefly. Remember, he's with the Philistines, a place he shouldn't be, and now he's about to be in a very compromising position where the Philistines are going to attack the Israelites, and King Achish is asking David, will you be with me when we do that? And David actually says, hey, I'm with you. But probably in the back of his head, he's like, oh my word, what am I going to do about this situation? But we'll see how that ends in the next chapter. But most of this chapter deals with Saul and just how far he's fallen. Now, so the chapter does make an emphasis of the fact that Saul, I don't know if it was right before this happened, but probably at the beginning of his reign, has ordered the removal of all people that practice witchcraft. And now, because he's scared of the army of the Philistines, he's inquiring of God, and he's not hearing any answer, he decides, you know what, I got to go find me a lady, a witch, who can allow me to hear again the words of Samuel. He's like, I need to find a witch that can bring Samuel's spirit to me so I can finally talk to my old mentor again. And it's just the fact that he had a stance against evil at one point in his life, and now he's stooped to this level where he's at now, where he's actually seeking out the very thing he outlawed. So he goes to this woman. He finds a woman. His men tell him about one, and she is kind of skeptical. She doesn't recognize that it's Saul at first. He's covering himself. And she says, are you trying to set me up for a trap? Don't you know that, like, witchcraft is outlawed? He's like, don't worry. I swear by the Lord. All right, he's using the Lord in this whole, he's using the Lord's name in vain, obviously, in this whole situation. He's like, I swear by the Lord, no evil will happen unto you. And she's like, all right, who do you want me to bring up? And he brings up, he says, bring me Samuel, the prophet who's now dead. Bring me up so I can hear his advice once again. And the Bible doesn't go into detail on what she does, but she is very surprised by the fact that Samuel actually does show up. Maybe she usually does some sort of charade or something like that, or maybe she did have some sort of familiarity with demonic spirits, whatever it may be, but she was definitely not expecting the actual Samuel to show up, and it very much scared her. And then she realized, oh, this is actually Saul, and she's now does she not only have to fear the fact that she has a spirit that she didn't expect to come, but now she has to fear for her life because she realizes this is actually King Saul that has come to her. And Saul doesn't care about any of that. He sees Samuel and he asks him, hey, what should I do about the Philistines? And Samuel rebukes him, saying, hey, this is all because of your sin. All this has come upon you because you did not obey God completely when he told you to take out the Amalekites, and now you're going to suffer the consequences for that. And he said, you and your sons are going to join me this time tomorrow. And it's just the fallout of all of Saul's disobedience, not turning back to God, no true repentance in any way. But the main thing I think that stood out to me in this chapter has to do with the fact that in his lowest moments, and all this time in which he refused to listen to God, and all this time when he was following his own will instead of the will of God, he was being prideful instead of humble, he now gets to a point where he wishes he could hear again from his old spiritual mentor, where he wishes he could hear again from the godly influence he had in his life at one point in time, and that is Samuel. And the thing I wanted to stick out to you guys today is, don't take for granted the spiritual leadership in your life. Don't take for granted the spiritual leadership in your life. Don't take for granted your pastor, your youth pastors, because there may come a time when you really need their advice. All right, don't ignore them now thinking they don't know what they're talking about, they don't know what I'm going through, because there may come a time in the future where you're like, I really wish I could get their advice. I really wish I could just hear what they have to say, what God has to say about this situation. And Saul was in that situation. So take advantage of it, guys, especially teenagers. Take advantage of the resources God has readily available to you today, your youth pastor, devotional series such as this one, your godly parents. Take advantage of those resources while you can today. Don't ignore them. Don't take them for granted. Because if you're in a situation where you start to go away from God and you're no longer in church, you may find yourself in a circumstance where you wish, oh man, I wish I could just pick up the phone and call them. Which in most cases, guys, you probably can. But in your selfishness, in your pride, you may feel like you can't do that. Don't take it for granted. Take advantage of the spiritual influences and leadership you have in your life today. That's it I have for today's chapter, guys. Stay tuned later today for the next chapter of 1 Samuel, and we'll get caught right back up next week as well. Stay safe, stay healthy. God bless.